Hey everyone, this week Pastor Chad continues his study in the book of Acts, specifically in chapter 24, discussing the sovereignty of God. Let's check it out.
If you believe two things, God is sovereign, he's in control, and God loves you, he wants the best for you. If you believe those two things, you will never worry again. That's a pretty big statement. I got it. I know it's a big statement, but I really believe that. I believe if you're living in stress, worry, and anxiety today, it's either because you don't believe God is in control, or you don't really believe God is for you and has your best interest at heart, or both of those things. And so today I want to hit again this idea that God is sovereign, God is in control. Folks, listen to me. We need a fresh vision of just how big and great God really is. We don't need another vision about us, our problems, our this, our that. We need a fresh vision about how big God really is. Once you start seeing God as he really is, everything else will start falling into place. In fact, I think it was Corrie Ten Boom that said, and I'm repeating this from memory, so I might get mixed up, but Corrie Ten Boom said something like this: look around and be distressed. Look within and be obsessed. Look at him and be at rest. Amen. Isn't that great? And so we need a fresh vision of who God really is. We need good theology. I love what R.T. Kendall said. R.T. Kendall, this really expresses what I'm trying to say. R.T. Kendall says this: most of theology in the church today is really anthropology. And here's what he means by this. Theology is the study of God. We come to church saying we're studying God. Actually, we're not. We're studying ourselves and our needs and our whatever. Most of what we call theology is actually anthropology. I want to get us a fresh vision of the sovereignty of God, that he is big, he is great, he is mighty, he is strong, he is in control. I want a fresh vision of that today. And so let's go back to Acts chapter 24. Acts 24, and let's pick up where we left off last week. Acts 24, 27. Y'all there? Acts 24, 27. When 2 years had passed, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus, because Felix wanted to grant a favor to the Jews, he left Paul in prison. Now, let's kind of do a review. Remember last week, Paul has been taken from Jerusalem. He was arrested in Jerusalem. He's been taken 60 miles down to the coast to a town called Caesarea. Caesarea is the seat of Roman government, okay? So he was in Caesarea, and last week we said he was on trial really before a pervert. This guy is named Felix. Felix was a wicked man. He was an inept governor. Remember we said last week, the only reason he had a job is because his brother was good friends with the emperor of Rome. So he's a bad leader. He's a pervert. He's married to a lady named Drusilla, who was married to another man before Felix came and stole her away. And so Paul's on trial. And remember last week I said, Paul was such a bold witness that Felix, the governor, went away afraid, okay? Now things have shifted. In 59 AD, Felix is called back to Rome because he's such a bad governor. And that's how we can date the book of Acts, because we know he's called back to Rome in 59 AD, actually. And so Rome sends a new governor to take his place, and it's a guy named Festus. Now, one of the preeminent historians of the age, Flavius Josephus, said, actually, Festus, the guy that took his place, is actually a good guy. He's a good leader. Problem is, he's only there for 2 years and he suddenly dies. But this is now who Paul is before. And in Acts 25, 1 through 12, I'm not going to read all that until it's happening. So now there's a new governor. Paul's on trial before him, this guy named Festus. And Festus is smart. He knows the Jewish leaders are trying to railroad the Apostle Paul. He knows that an innocent man has been accused. And so he's trying to walk a tight line. He wants to curry favor with the Jews because now he has to kind of lead them as a Roman. But he also wants to see an innocent man go free. And the Apostle Paul basically says this. Paul says, I've had enough. I've been jerked around for the last 2 years. And so Paul finally says in Acts chapter 25, he uses a technical phrase. He says, Caesarem appello. Caesarem appello. I appeal to Caesar. Now, remember, Paul's a Jew, but he's also a Roman citizen. And Roman citizens had the right at any moment to say, I appeal to Caesar, and everything stops, and you go to Rome, and Caesar himself judges you. And so Paul finally says, I've had enough of this. It's been 2 years. I appeal to Caesar. Okay? So that's what happens. Now, I want you to go back again to verse. I'm going to show you about three or four examples today in the Bible that God is sovereign. He is in control. And the first example was what I just read, Acts 24:27, when 2 years had passed. Paul's been in prison for 2 years. I can imagine Paul's like some of us. At some point in that 2 years, he had to say, God, do you even know what you're doing? See, Paul's used to being out, active, planting churches, doing stuff, and now he's just in a prison cell for 2 years. That had to start working on Paul's mind. God, do you know what you're doing? Answer is, God does know what he's doing. Where do you see the sovereignty of God here? Let me ask you this. Who wrote the book of Acts? Y'all remember who wrote the book of Acts? Gospel, yeah, it's a man named Luke. Dr. Luke wrote the book of Acts. He also wrote a second book that we have in the Bible. Anybody know what the book is? Luke, the Gospel of Luke, okay? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Now, I'm going to ask you a question, and don't say Paul, okay? Who wrote the Bible? Who wrote more of the New Testament than any other person? Luke. If you add the Gospel of Luke, remember that's one of the biographies of Jesus, if you get the Gospel of Luke and you add it to Acts, volume 2, those two together, Luke actually wrote more of the New Testament than even the Apostle Paul did, okay? Now, how in the world did he write Luke? So here's what's happening. Luke, up to this point, remember, we've been studying the book of Acts. Up to this point, Luke uses the plural pronoun we. Paul and I went here. Paul and I went there. All the way up to Jerusalem, it's Luke and Paul. Okay? So he is a traveling companion of Paul. When Paul is put in prison for 2 years, guess who's with him? Luke. But Luke's not put in prison. His companion, Paul, is sitting in prison for 2 years, and now Luke is like, well, what am I supposed to do? Okay? Well, here's what Luke does. I want you to look, if you would, at the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verse 1. This is the introduction to the Gospel of Luke. And evidently, there was a wealthy Roman convert to Christianity named Theophilus who said, look, I want somebody to write the definitive biography of Jesus. I want somebody to study the life of Jesus and write a biography. And he commissioned Luke to do it. And Luke says this in Luke chapter 1. Verse 1, many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. With this in mind, since I myself have carefully investigated everything about the life of Jesus from the beginning, I too decided to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the certainty of things you have been taught. Now look at verse 3. Paul says, I investigated the life of Jesus. Okay? That word investigated in Greek literally means to follow near or to follow close behind. So here's what Luke says. Now again, Luke's not from Israel. He's a Hellenistic Jew. He's from Greece somewhere, okay? Here's what Luke says. He says, I followed the footsteps of Jesus. I walked around the Holy Land, I walked around Palestine, and I interviewed people who knew Jesus when he was a little boy. I interviewed people who were there when he walked on the water. I interviewed people who heard Jesus preach. I personally sat down and interviewed people who said, I have seen him with my own eyes. He is risen from the dead. When did Luke have a chance to do that? When would he have had that kind of time to walk around the Holy Land and do his investigation? It's while his friend Paul is in prison for 2 years, he takes that opportunity to write the Gospel of Luke. Let me put it this way. Had Paul not been in prison for 2 years, you would not have the Gospel of Luke in your Bible. God is sovereign. God is in control. And God says, Paul, you may not understand this. You may not appreciate this. It may not make sense to you, but I am sovereign. There's a reason why you've been waiting for 2 years. And now we, 2,000 years later, know what that reason is. God used that to birth the Gospel of Luke. He is sovereign. He is in control. Y'all believe that? Let me give you a second example of this. So we'll fast forward a little bit. When Paul leaves Caesarea in prison, he will now be in prison in the capital city of the Roman Empire, Rome. And so while Paul is a prisoner in Rome, he actually writes a letter to one of the churches that he planted, the church at Philippi. We know that as what book in your Bible? Philippians. When you read Philippians, it's a letter Paul wrote to that church that he planted in Philippi. And Paul says something very interesting. Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 12, now he's saying to the church, now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. In other words, I'm in prison, I don't want to be in prison. Don't you understand this? God is sovereign, and God is using me being in prison to advance the gospel. Verse 13, as a result, it has become clear throughout the whole, now look at this, palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. Underline that in verse 13, palace guard. In some of your translation, it says Praetorian guard. Okay, what does that mean? Well, when Paul first got to Rome as a prisoner, he actually had two places where he's in prison. One was in the palace guard or the Praetorian prison, okay? It was a prison located in the basement of Caesar's house. Later on, he'll be taken from that prison to a horrible prison. It's called the Mamertine prison. Filthy place. The city sewer ran right through the Mamertine prison. And that's where Paul will spend his final days. But he's saying right here, he said, no, right now, I'm in the Praetorian prison. I'm in the palace prison. I'm in Caesar's basement. Now, this is really interesting. There's an elite group of Navy SEAL, Green Beret combination called the Praetorian Guards that guarded the Praetorian prison. And I read a little bit about this. They were actually first formulated by Caesar Augustus years before. Again, they're an elite group of people. And what they would do, watch this, is they were the personal bodyguards of Caesar and his household, okay? So after they'd go on shift and guard Caesar and his household, then they would go down into the basement of Caesar's household and guard the most notorious prisoners in the entire Roman Empire. And then after they did that for a while, they would take another shift upstairs to guard Caesar's household. Then they'd go back down to the basement and guard the notorious prisoners. Then they'd go back up to Caesar's household. And then after a while, many of these elite Green Beret, Navy SEAL guys would be sent out all around the world, okay? So you get the picture? Guarding Caesar's household, guarding the prisoners, going up and guarding Caesar's house, going to, and then finally going around the world. And Paul says, I'm in the basement right here. Now imagine this. Imagine you have one of these elite Praetorian guards. He has just gotten off duty down in the basement, and as he's walking out, he's shaking. His eyes are this big, and he's walking out, and his replacement is coming in, and his replacement says, man, what's wrong? He said, man, we got a tough prisoner here. Oh, really? He said, we've guarded some tough guys. He said, no. We've never guarded anybody like this. The guy's like, man, let me see. And so he goes over there, and he looks in the prison cell, and there's this little short, bald-headed Jew just sitting there like this. And he said, that's the guy? Oh, yeah, he's tough. He said, man, I'll show him who's boss. And he goes in there, shuts the cell door, puts one end of the handcuffs around himself, fastens the other end around Paul, and as soon as those handcuffs fasten, Paul says, praise God, captive audience, man, take out a paper, a pencil. We got some work to do. I'm going to start with theology. I'm going to talk to you about the creation, the fall of man, the virgin birth of Christ, the substitutionary atonement, the second coming of Jesus, and for 8 hours, he has to sit there while Paul just goes on and on and on and on. That poor guard had no chance, did he? And I believe some of those guards got saved. Why? Because when you look at the way Paul closes out his letter, Philippians chapter 4, verse 21, Paul's being a little bit, you know, he's a little bit sarcastic here. He says to the Philippian church, greet all God's people in Christ Jesus. The brothers and sisters who are with me here in Rome send greetings. All God's people here send you greetings, especially those who belong to Caesar's household. In other words, what Satan meant for evil, God meant for good. Satan thought he could shut me up in Caesar's basement. He made a fatal flaw. Did you know this? God is always 5 steps above beyond Satan. Satan thought he could shut Paul up, and God turned that around and used it for good and let Caesar's own household get born again because some of these soldiers went up and witnessed after they got saved. And furthermore, what did I tell you? They would go all around the world to places like Britannia, England, Gaul, France. And what do you think these Praetorian guards who had been chained to Paul, who got saved, what do you think they did when they went to these different locations? They shared the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. God is sovereign. Now let me just, y'all believe what I'm saying? I mean, I'm serious. Do you believe God is sovereign? God is in charge? You believe he's in control? Let me give you one more example. Look at Romans 8:28. Another great example of the sovereignty of God. Paul says this in Romans 8:28. And we know that God causes everything. Now, let me just stop here. Look, I don't want to be a stereotypical preacher, okay? Turn to your neighbor and say, he's not a stereotypical preacher. I'm joking. All right. I don't want to miss, but I want you, some of y'all got it. I want you to repeat that word, everything. God causes how much? Everything to work together for good. Those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. Now, let me ask you something. Does this thing say that God causes all things? It doesn't say that. It doesn't say God causes all things. Does God cause divorce? No, he hates divorce. Does God cause cancer? You can't convince me God causes cancer. Do you believe, we're not going to talk about this today, but here's an issue I got to start addressing. I don't want to address it, but I'm going to have to. We have a funeral director that goes to our church. He said, Chad, this is last year. He said, Chad, there's a season here, I don't know if it's still the same now, where the number one cause of death in Wake County is suicide. I don't have to talk about suicide, but we've had four people somehow connected to our church in the last year take their own lives. And so we're going to have to hit that sometime down the road. But let me ask something. Does God cause suicide? No. So you Calvinists, you hyper, 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 hyper Calvinists who say God causes everything, that's okay. But if you believe that, you have to believe that God is also the author of sin, and he's not. So that verse does not say God causes everything. It does say this, though. God causes everything to work together for good. God can take something beautiful out of that divorce and bring life into something dead. God can take something beautiful out of your cancer battle. He didn't cause it. We live in a fallen world. That wasn't part of God's intention when he created human beings. But God can still cause illness to somehow turn around and work together for good. That's the sovereignty of God. Don't ask me how he does it. And when you're in the middle of it, it doesn't make sense. And when you're in the middle of it, it doesn't feel like it. But if you don't believe that, if you don't believe that God can bring something good out of bankruptcy, God can bring something good out of your battle with cancer, if you don't believe that, then you better take that verse out of the Bible. Because that verse says God causes everything to work together for good. Does that make sense? In fact, a lot of y'all may not know this, but because I kind of seem rough around the edges sometimes, but I actually come from a long line of artists. Did you know that? My granny was an artist way down in the deep south. She made this beautiful creation. Some of you Yankees won't appreciate this, but it's something called a cat head biscuit. Do you know what a cat head biscuit is? It's not one of these Hungry Jack things where you pop it up with a can and put it on the... No, that's not it. She would make these biscuits that big and that round. Crunchy on the outside, fluffy on the inside, and she would serve, you know, a defibrillator with every biscuit, you know, so that when your arteries get clogged, you can... And my granny had the ability to take some nasty ingredients. In fact, she would start with lard. Y'all know what lard is? It's not, you know, it's not your non-saturated essential olive oil or whatever y'all use. That's not what it is. Lard is pig fat. She started with pig fat, and then she would take some flour. Have you ever eaten just raw flour? It's nasty. She'd take pig fat. She would take flour. She'd take salt. Now, you don't just, you know, eat a whole thing of salt. Salt's nasty if you try to do that, right? And then she'd take the nastiest thing of all. It's called buttermilk. Have you ever had buttermilk before? Now, look, I'm not judging you, but if you like buttermilk, you are a certified psychopath. Nobody likes buttermilk. It's nasty. Somehow, some way, she'd take pig fat, flour, salt, buttermilk, combine them all together, and she'd make this beautiful creation that we call a biscuit. It's absolutely amazing. If my granny can do that with nasty ingredients, don't you think God can take anything that is thrown at him, combine it, bring it together, and produce something good for you? Do you believe that? That's the sovereignty of God. Now, I'm going to ask you again. And I'm not just being rhetorical. I mean this. Do you believe God is sovereign? Because the sovereignty of God has some profound implications. Let me give those to you. Number one, If God is sovereign, he's in control, then I can wait on him. If the Apostle Paul can wait for God for 2 years, knowing that God is moving behind the scenes, you can wait on God in your life. In fact, some of y'all are right at a crossroads right now. You need to know, what am I supposed to do? Do I go this way or that way? Listen to me. God does not lead in doubt. He leads in assurity. And until you know what God wants you to do, I just say wait on God. As a pastor, I can tell you, look, we're called to do a lot of things as followers of Jesus Christ. One of the hardest things we're called to do is wait on God. And I have never made a mistake when I waited on God. Every mistake I've made as a pastor is when I run ahead of God. You can wait on God if he's sovereign. In fact, I love this story. Let me give you this verse. Hey, would y'all memorize? We don't do scripture memorization like we used to. I want us all to start memorizing some Bible verses. Here's a great Bible verse to memorize. It's Isaiah 64:4, and it says this. Isaiah says, "For since the world began, no ear has heard, and no eye has seen a God like you, who works for those who do what? Wait for him. You wait, God works. You panic, God says, fine, you can handle this or I can handle this. If you'll wait on me, I'll handle this thing." Okay? I love this story. This economist years ago read 2 Peter 3:8 through 9, which says, "With God, 1,000 years is like one day." And so this economist prayed and he said, "God, I read that verse." So that verse basically says, 1,000 years is like a minute to you. God said, "Yes." He said, "Then God, $1 million is like a penny to you." God said, "Yes." He said, "Well, then God, will you give me a penny?" God said, "Sure, wait just a minute." You know, some of the greatest people of God have had to wait. David is anointed king of Israel. And yet, if you look at the chronology of the Old Testament, David is an anointed king of Israel, but he doesn't become king for 10 years. And he had plenty of opportunities to take out the man that was standing in his way. And he said, "No, I'm going to wait on God." Anointed king, but doesn't become king for 10 years. Here's another example. Jesus comes to planet Earth on a mission to save the world. Jesus comes to Earth and has to wait 30 years before he starts his ministry. Let me give you another example. Paul is born again. God radically saves him. He's called to be the greatest missionary the world has ever seen. And yet, if you look at the chronology of Acts, he has to wait 10 years before he actually becomes a missionary. One of my heroes in the faith is a man. Have you heard of William Carey? They call William Carey the father of modern missions. There was no missions in the church in the 1700s. And William Carey came along, and he read the Bible, and he says, "Man, we're supposed to go into all the world." And so William Carey is called to Burma in Southeast Asia, okay? He leaves with his family, goes to Burma. His first wife dies. Conditions are so horrible, his second wife loses her mind. She goes crazy. He spends years translating the Bible into the language of the people that he'll be ministering to. Years! And one night, that manuscript catches on fire and it's all burned up. It's 7 years from the time he goes into the mission field to the time he gets his first convert. Now, I'm going to tell you this. You start pushing God. You try to force God's hand and you don't wait on God, you can make a mess. Some of the biggest messes in the Bible were made by people who couldn't wait on God. God says to Abraham, "I know you're 75 years old, but you're going to have a son, and through that son, all the nations will be blessed." God starts looking at the actuary tables and he says, "I'm not going to have a kid anytime soon. If God does not hurry up, I'm not going to have a kid." And so he and his wife have this plan. His wife says, "Honey, look, we have a beautiful maid, young maid that works in our house named Hagar. Why don't you just go have sex with her and have a child through her, and then we can kind of push God's hand and we can get that child of promise." And Abraham says, "Well, I don't want to, but I'll take one for the team." And so he does it. He has a child named Ishmael. Ishmael is the father of the Arabs. When God finally does move in his life, he produces Isaac, that's the father of the Jews, and we are still living with a conflict today that Abraham started in 2000 BC. Why? Because he couldn't wait on God. Moses sensed a call of God on his life to deliver God's people from bondage. And one day he goes out and he kills an Egyptian soldier. I guess he thought he was going to relieve God's people from bondage by picking off, you know, one Egyptian soldier at a time or something. I don't know what it is. But God says, basically, Moses, as a result, you now have to go on the backside of the desert and wait for 40 years before I can use you again. Folks, I'm just telling you, if God is sovereign, you can wait on him. Secondly, if God is sovereign, then I can relax in him. I can rest in him. And say it again. In a day of coronavirus this, and election 2020 that, and everybody freaking out and losing their heads, I'm going to say it again. God's people ought to be the most restful, relaxed, joyful people in this world. We should not be stressing like everybody else stresses. Pastor, that's not reasonable. That's too much to ask. Here's what my Bible says. Don't worry about anything, but in everything, with prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Don't tell me Jesus doesn't want us to relax and rest. It's in the Bible. If you believe God is sovereign, you believe he's in control, you can rest in him. Arthur Barbara Taylor said one time she had a friend coming to visit, and his friend got lost. And so while she's panicked trying to find Barbara's house, she didn't pay attention to her speedometer, and she's now speeding, and she got a speeding ticket as well. And the officer came to her window, knocked on the window, she rolled the window down, and the officer said, "Ma'am, why were you speeding?" She tried to explain it to the officer. She said, "Well, officer, I was speeding because I'm lost." I like the officer's response. He said, "Ma'am, I'm sorry to hear that you're lost, but what made you think that going faster would help you find your way?" And I'm asking some of you, what makes you think running around with your head like a chicken with its head cut off, panicked, worried like everybody else, what makes you think that's going to get you to your destination faster? If God is sovereign, you can rest and relax in him. Let me give you one more. Number three. If God is sovereign, then I can trust in him. If he is who Pastor Chad and this Bible says he is, he's big, mighty, all-knowing, all-powerful, all-present, sovereign. If he is who we say he is, then we can just trust in him. In fact, I love what Abraham says. Abraham says in Genesis 18:25, "Will not the judge of all the earth just do what's right?" In other words, if he's God, everything he does is right. Listen to me. God makes sense even when he doesn't make sense. Why? Because he's God. He's sovereign. You can trust him. When one of my kids was 3 years old, I did something really mean to him. He was playing with this really cool toy that was attached to our wall. Had three little holes in it. And he was going up to that cool little toy with something metal and trying to poke it in there. And I saw him and I yelled, "Stop!" And I smacked that right out of his hand. And of course, he started crying. "Why is Daddy being mean to me when all I want to do is just have fun with this neat little toy called an outlet?" Now, I could have tried to explain to him that, hey, they're the subatomic particles called electrons. They're going to send 120 volts of energy into your body. You can go to cardiac fibrillation. And I could have tried to explain that. Do you think my three-year-old son would have known what I was talking about? No. All he knew was Daddy was being mean by yelling and smacking that thing out of my hand. Daddy was not being mean. Daddy was looking out for that kid's best interest. And some of you think that God is silent now in your life because he's mean or he's angry. Maybe he's not angry. Maybe he's working behind the scenes and God says, "Hey, if I even began to try to explain to you, it wouldn't even make sense to you." How many of you would agree that the knowledge, the intelligence between that three-year-old son and me as an adult doesn't even begin to compare to my knowledge now and the knowledge of the omniscient God of the universe? That knowledge gap between that three-year-old and me might be this much. That knowledge gap between me and God is infinite. He knows what he's doing. And it may not make sense, and you may think he's angry. I'm telling you, God is sovereign. God is in control.
Well, everyone, as Pastor Chad said, if God is sovereign, we can wait on him. We can rest in him. and we can trust in Him overall. Thanks for watching this message. We hope you enjoyed it. And for more, you can check out our YouTube channel and follow us on social media to stay in the know. See you next week.